Then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his This is he which receiveth seed by the wayside. I might use for a word this morning, something to encourage your heart. It would be life on the edge. I thought to say living on the edge, but I just want to say in general, life on the edge. I've always been amazed as a child of God, and I guess more so as a pastor, a man of God, is that Jesus always was able to communicate truth. I don't know where people get off thinking that for some reason the Bible has gotten old-fashioned, or the Bible needs to be highlighted by our antics, or by our programs, or by our stuff. But the Word of God is truth right by itself. It doesn't need any addition, nor does it need any subtraction. Because when the Lord would speak, he didn't have microphones monitored, he didn't have a PR team. The Lord would just speak the Word of God, and people would be drawn to the truth. I know he was a celebrity. I know folk would follow Jesus because they heard about him. I know folk would follow him because of the miracles he did. But by and by, and all in all, they would be caught up in the truth that he would present, bring forth from his lips, because they had never heard such truth. And the Word of God is truth right by itself. It doesn't need to be highlighted. Doesn't need to be given anything or anything taken away from it. The Word of God is right by itself. The Lord would communicate his message, his truth, whether it be a few folk, one folk, or a multitude of folk. Jesus would take time to share the truth. That's why none of us, all of us, will be without excuse to say that God never took opportunity to share the truth with us. God will make it available. I don't care if you got a believing relative, a believing mom, dad, sister, brother, or someone who encouraged you, took you to church, or read the Bible to you, did the Sunday school, did the Songs of Zion. You were faced or even heard, or it was exposed to you, songs and testimonies and praise. At some point in time in your life, you were exposed to truth. And truth is something that we have to consider, something we got to scratch our head with about and consider, at least give it time and thought to consider whether it is indeed truth or fact or fiction. And Jesus would make every effort to share the truth of the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Jesus would plead with the religious leaders. He would plead with the disciples. He said, listen, believe what I'm saying and accept it as truth. Stop acting like it's not truth. Stop acting like it's just some religious exercise. It's truth. Right. And if I preach truth, then there's a consequence to believing truth. The Bible says if you believe the truth, you'll be set free. If you believe the truth, there's something that will take place in your spirit, take place in your life. There'll be an indication that you indeed heard the truth. Jesus would make every effort to convince them. John 14:11, Jesus said on one occasion, he said, believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for my very work's sake. He said, listen, you don't believe what I say. You don't believe that God is in me. He said, believe at least what I've done. Right. And you know, we have that problem today. A lot of folks follow Jesus for what he's done, but still don't believe the truth. As long as he keeps doing it, I'm fine. Once he stopped, then I got a trouble with unbelief. I got a problem with believing that God was in it at all. He said, listen, if you don't believe me, don't believe that the Father is in me. He said, at least believe the work that I've done. Look at your life. Look back over your life and see where I've kept you, where I've been with you, where I've done what I've done, because I am God. Nobody could have done it but God. Nobody could have brought you out but God. Nobody could have kept you. You should have died in the accident, but God kept you. Mm-hmm. You, there was a calamity in your life years ago, and you should not have, you shouldn't even be here. But God reached his hand in the situation and saw fit to bring you out. He said, at least believe me for my works. Glory to God. In our text, Jesus is speaking truth to his followers as well as the onlookers. There was a lot of folk that followed Jesus for the food. A lot of folks would look at Jesus from a distance. You have a window shop? Yes. That's what folk would do with Jesus, a window shop. They stand back from a distance and watch him. They didn't really want what he had, but they wanted to see what he was doing. Yes. curious, but never curious enough to say yes to the will of God. Some folks, I like to go to church because it's a nice place to go. It's very social. But I really don't, I have a good time. Well, are you saved? I'm not really looking to get saved. I'm just looking to be in church because I enjoy a good time. Onlookers. Folks followed Jesus for the food. Once the lunch video was over, they left and went back to business as usual. But God wants us to receive the truth so that the truth can change our life. Look what it says here, Matthew 13, 2 and 3. It says, listen, and great multitudes were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat, and whole multitudes stood on the shore. And he spake many things unto them in parables. Behold, a sower went forth to sow. Jesus would speak in parables, and parables were stories. They were really fictitious, but they were trying to bring about a moral thought, a moral process, so that he would cause you to think about something he was saying. So he would speak in parables, and many would follow him because the parables had a spiritual meaning. Amen. But he used parables to incite them, to encourage them, to move them to long after God. God said, listen, I even draw you. Even when you were an unbeliever, before God saved you, the Bible said he drew you by love and kindness. God said, I was good to you so that you would know I was good. I was good to you so you know you'd be blessed if you followed my truth and followed my word.
Amen.
So they would follow him, but yet he would speak in parables. So that if I spoke in a parable and it was enough to incite you to seek after me, then it accomplished its purpose. See, because there's no reason to tell you the truth if you're not going to believe it anyhow. But if I tell you a story that points you to the truth, and you have enough, amen, insight and enough interest in you to follow, Jesus said, then the parable has accomplished what I sent it to do. So folk would follow him and make every effort to hear what he had to say. Glory to God. Look at Matthew 13 and 10. And the disciples came and said unto him, why speakest thou in parables? And Jesus gave a real long dissertation, even up to the 16th verse. But he was declaring that I speak in parables because to them that need to know, they don't know.
Amen.
Them that need to hear, they don't hear. He said, but for them that want to hear, they'll hear. For them that desire the truth will know the truth. See, somebody said, I'm searching for God and I can't find him. Understand this. If you seek after God, you'll find him.
Amen.
If you seek after him, he's available. The Bible says if we knock, he'll answer. If we ask, he'll respond. If we seek, we'll find. So Jesus was making every effort to clear up and communicate the truth of the Bible, the truth of the gospel, so that men, women, boys, and girls would say yes to his will and yes to the word of God, which does not change. It is God's intention.
Mm-hmm.
It's God's intention that we hear and know the truth, for apart from it, we are bound. The Bible says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So God is not teasing us. He's not holding a carrot over our head with parables. Rather, he's trying to incite us to know the truth. Jesus did it. He would preach for hours. He would preach for days to communicate the truth of God's word so that all would believe and come to know him as the Messiah. St. John 8:32 says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Knowing the truth, again, I said it's not an exercise. It's not something we ought to do just to do it. But it's the means by which we understand God. God cares that we know him and understand him. He cares. It concerns God that we are, amen, living a lie. He'd rather us be in the truth. Amen. Isaiah 55 and 6 says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Jeremiah 29 and 13 says, listen, and ye shall seek me and find me when ye search for me with trying to be hidden. He says, if you seek me, you'll find me. If you seek after me with all your heart, he said, you will find me. It won't be an accident. I won't be hiding from you. Why? Because my desire is that you know and understand me and know the truth. Jesus spoke in parables and folks didn't understand. But he said, I spoke in parables to them that have not a desire to understand.
Yes.
Because if they did understand, they would be moved and encouraged to seek after me.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Oftentimes I would be concerned myself as a brother in the Lord, as a pastor, why people do not understand the necessity of the Word of God and the need to know God's Word. And truth must be lived. Truth, first of all, must be believed, and second, must be lived. So just because you presented the truth doesn't mean everybody believes it.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you believe the truth, then you are given power, or should I say power is released through the Word of God, that you have freedom now to obey God.
Amen.
You have freedom to believe God.
Freedom.
In other words, you can take God at his word. Jesus told the disciples at one time, he said, if thou say unto this mountain, and don't doubt in your heart, he said, you can say to this mountain, be thou removed, and it shall be removed from you. Why? That's true. He said, if you believe in your heart, and don't doubt my word to you, he said, you can say to this situation and on this circumstance, and it's got to respond to the truth. Glory to God.
Right.
It's got to respond.
Right.
It's got to move. Something has to take place. Glory to God. He spoke to them in parables because they couldn't hear, nor could they understand. God is not a man, therefore to know him, we must seek him. He's not a man, we must seek him. Why? Because his thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. Isaiah 55:8. God is different from us. Therefore, God has to deposit his spirit in us so that we know him. Apart from his spirit, we'll never know him. But God says, seek me with your whole heart.
Amen.
This parable deals with a farmer. It gives the analogy of a farmer sowing seed in a field. And he sowed seed in a field such so to bring about a crop. No farmer tills the ground. No farmer plows the ground. No farmer throws seed in the soil and doesn't expect a fruit to come forth. He expects a harvest to come forth as a result of his effort. He's believing for rain. He's believing for the necessary sunshine. He's believing for that rabbits and other critters won't eat his seed. He's believing for harvest. So God says, I'm using this same analogy concerning the Word of God. I want you to understand that when the Word of God is sown, when it's thrown out to the field, when it's thrown out to good ground, he said the ground, if it comes forth and it's ground such that it doesn't hit the soil, but it falls on the wayside, he said, then fowls of the air come along and snatch it so it doesn't bring forth fruit. And he symbolized this as saying that the enemy of our soul snatches the word of God when the seed of God's word doesn't fall on good ground. And that's why I like to talk about living on the edge or life on the edge. Many people receive God's word on the edge. In other words, they have no root, nor they have no soil. There's no depth. There's no thickness to their concentration. They've heard the word, but it doesn't take root because as soon as the word of God is released, the enemy of our soul snatches that which could fall on good ground. And it finds its way on that which has no depth or no thickness.
Uh-huh.
Life on the edge. Many people live like that. Live to the point that they're just on the fringes of the truth.
Yes.
I mean, they're living like they're cliffhanging. They're not willing to step back and believe God, but they're more willing to hear that which excites And because it was stony ground and the heat of the day and the situations that come in our life, he said the stony ground, that they would receive it and say, yes, Lord, do your will. But as soon as there was heat, as soon as there was trouble, as soon as there was circumstance, they would fall back in as if they never heard the word at all. Stony ground. It had no root and it had no substance. Then there were those that the word of God fell on, and thorns grew up. And the thorns would choke the word. And he said the thorns referred to as the cares of this life. And it let us know that cares can choke the word of God, because we can be consumed with ourselves to the extent that we don't take God at his word. And I look at all these ground. One was on the wayside, one was on stony ground, one was in thorns, and all of them have something in common.
Yes.
None of them have any depth. None of them have any thickness. None of them have any soil that could produce life or produce a fertile ground so that the seed could bring forth fruit. You know, God desires that we don't live on the edge. God wants us to live in fertile territory so that we, when the word of God falls on us, we can respond to it and it bring forth fruit. Look what the Bible says here. I love this. It says here that the word would fall on the wayside or the edge, and that the fowls of the air would snatch it so it didn't bring forth fruit. You know, it's the enemy of our souls, but he's not the only enemy you have. It's the world, the flesh, and the devil. But the enemy of our souls, his design is to deceive us. His design is to keep us in deception so that we can think we're doing right when we're doing wrong. Why? Because he's able to catch the word so the word of God doesn't take forth fruit or take forth root and bring forth fruit. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 4:3, but if our gospel is hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them.
Amen.
He says, listen, the gospel is still good news, but the gospel is hidden to them whose mind have been blinded by the enemy of this world.
Right.
He said they're blinded. In other words, when the word of God is sown and has an opportunity to take root in some good soil, the enemy blinds you to the truth of the word.
Right.
So that the word has no substance. The word has no value. Actually, you begin to question if it is indeed the word. And that's his motive operandi. That's what he does. The devil doesn't care that you were in church. The devil doesn't care that you go to church.
Yes.
But if he can keep you blinded,
yes.
It didn't say you were blind.
Right.
It said he blinds the mind.
Yes, sir.
So you don't believe.
Bye-bye.
Every time the word is about to take root, you question what the word is, because he blinds. Glory to God. He blinds you to the truth that the word represents. Oh, I'm here looking to hear a word from God. You come to church with anticipation. You come to a Bible study. You go to prayer with anticipation. Whatever you plan to do, whether it be worship God, you do it with anticipation. But as soon as you step into that arena, the enemy says, I'm going to blind them to the truth that what they're doing is valuable or not. I'm going to make them question their motives so that they don't receive the fruit of good ground. He said, I'll blind them, because the gospel is not hid, but we are being blinded. I thought to call this message, you've been robbed.
Uh-huh.
Because the Bible says in 2 John 10:10 that the thief cometh but for to kill, to steal, and to destroy.
Yes.
So I said, you've been robbed. In other words, it's his place to steal, kill, and destroy so that the word of God doesn't have any effect in your life. So that the word of God is powerless to bring forth fruit. When you talk about the way, it was basically the wayside. It was really a place off course, if you will. It had no significance. It had no value. It was like the shoulder of the road. It was a place that wasn't intended to grow fruit. It wasn't the main field. It wasn't the place of harvest. It wasn't the place of blessing. So the devil says, as long as I can keep you with your life on the edge, you'll never bring forth fruit. You'll never prosper. You'll never be blessed. Because as soon as the word of God is sown, I'll blind you. Whew, glory. I'll blind you. You ever been blinded? You ever had your heart set on a certain thing and God has been ministering to you, and as soon as you're about to believe it, you're blinded? Why? Because that's his job. That's his purpose. The enemy of our faith is a constant deceiver.
Yes.
He is relentless. Jude 4, the fourth verse says, listen, for there are certain men crept in unaware who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Jude says, listen, beware of them that creep in and declare the grace of God to be caught up and wrapped up in lasciviousness, which is uncleanness. Why? Because the devil said, if I can blind you to the truth, I can blind you to what is right, glory to God, and what is wrong.
Right.
You'll say right is wrong, you'll say wrong is right. He said, if I can blind you. Why? They crept in unaware. They were ordained to take down and to destroy. They were ordained to steal, kill, and destroy. Life on the edge. You're living there. You're never really getting fed. You're never really getting nourished because you're living on nothing. Nothing ever comes to anything. Nothing ever builds anything. It's life on the edge.
No.
God said, I'm ready to bless you, and you won't walk into the blessing. You think about the children of Israel, 40 years. And God had to do away with several generations of people in order so that them that would believe could walk on the promise. Understand this. Them that did not believe had no value on the promise. They would have not benefited. They would have been a thorn in the side. They would have been part of the back to Egypt crowd. But God said, no, I'm going to weed out them. If it takes 40 years, I'm going to weed them that don't believe. So that when we get to joy, glory to God, and we walk into the promise, you'll see nothing but fruit and faith, because my word will produce it.
Amen.
God doesn't want you to live your life on the edge. Glory, glory, glory. It's not necessarily a choice, it's an opportunity. It's an opportunity for God to bless you. God said, listen, I've already chosen the path you ought to walk. I determined it. Not to walk on the edge, but to walk right down my will. Right in the center of my purpose. Matthew 7 and 13 says, listen, enter ye in at the straight gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many there be that go therein, which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. The wayside, the broad way, takes little or no effort to choose. It's not even a battle to say no to God. It's not even a battle to walk in unbelief. You know what the battle is? Taking God at his word. And saying, Lord, I'm going to stand, and having done all the steps, I'm going to believe you regardless of who says no. I'm not going to live beneath my privilege. I'm not going to live my life on the edge, because God greater purpose for my life. Glory, glory, glory. What a mighty God we serve. As believers, we need constant illumination. Otherwise, we could be blinded to the very truth that God is releasing to us. Psalms 119 and 105, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Amen.
When I read God's word, when I meditate on God's word, when I'm illuminated by God's word, it allows me not only to stand, but it allows me to walk. So that I'm not walking on the edge. I'm not living my life on the edge, but rather I'm walking in the center of the will of God and allowing God to bring forth the fruit that he has determined as a result of me taking him at his word.
Amen.
Amen. That's the kind of God we serve. A God that's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask to think. Ephesians 3 and 20. He's able to do it exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think. Glory to God. Glory to God. The test of your faith. The test of our faith. Glory to God. The test of our faith as well as the cares of life will cause the word of God in us to be unfruitful. If we fail to take God at his word. Look what the Bible says here in 1 Peter 5 and 6. It says this. Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Why? God said it's necessary that in times of test, and in times of trial, and in times of situation, and in times of burden, to cast all your care on him. Why? Because we want the word of God to be fruitful. We don't want the word of God to be barren. We want the word of God to be fruitful so that we're able to stand and having done all to stand. Why? Because we are in a fight. We have an adversary, and he's after our very fruit of the word of God in us. God, the devil don't want you to be blessed, but God says you're blessed before the foundation of the world. The devil don't want you to stand and having done all to stand, but God says, listen, you take me at your word, and I'll keep you. I'll hallow your name. I'll bless your name. I'll give you that which you need. Amen. For whenever you need it. That's the kind of God that we serve. Why? Because we are in a battle. Understand this. Look at all that's been transpired even within this last month in our country. Don't you think you need the word of God to bring forth fruit in your life? I love the fact that he said the first is 100, then 60, then 30. God said, listen, I can release on my behalf because my word can't fail a harvest in your life when you believe.
Amen.
Glory to God. You don't have to live on the edge. You don't have to live on the fringes. You don't have to, amen, walk in unbelief when you take God at his word. I know he's able.
Yeah.
Amen. I know he's able. I know he's willing. I know he's mighty. Glory, glory, glory. Look what it says here. Be sober. Be vigilant. In other words, be courageous.
Yeah.
Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. The Bible says, listen, amen, be sober, be vigilant, be steadfast. Recognize this. Don't live your life on the edge. Rather, trust God for the abundance that his word can produce. Be vigilant. Why? Because your brethren, your sisters, amen, your relatives, all of them that believe are going through the same thing you are going through. You're not by yourself. And if God can bring them out, he can bring you out. If God can make a way for them, he can make a way for you. Amen. You don't have to live on the edge. You don't have to live on the fringes. You can walk right down the center and the middle of God's promise and take him at his word.
Thank you, Lord.
I know he's able. Regardless of how hot it gets, regardless of how cold it gets, regardless of how depressing it may seem, I know God is able.
Yeah.
And his word can't fail. I don't care how Congress changes their mind. I don't care how the senators vote tomorrow. All I know that in Christ I have the victory.
Yeah.
He's able to give me the victory.
Yeah.
And I stand in the purpose and the me. He said, if I trust him, he would keep me.
Yes.
I know he's able.
Amen.
I don't care how many folk want to live wrong. I'm still trusting God to live right.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how many want to live wrong. You keep living wrong. You keep living on the edge. Somebody said, oh, you just hate. No, I'm not just hating. I'm telling the truth.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Wrong can only produce wrong.
Yeah.
Don't deceive yourself. Don't let the devil blind you again. You've been robbed. You've been hoodwinked to think that wrong will produce wrong. All right, it won't happen.
Yeah.
Wrong will continually produce wrong. Amen. It may not come today nor tomorrow, but understand this. It's coming.
Yes, amen.
Amen. That's not to scare you, that's just the truth.
Right.
The truth is, amen, that if we walk in the light as he is in the light,
yes.
The Bible said we have fellowship.
Yes.
Amen. Not only with him, but with one another.
Yes, love.
Because of the light of the Word of God,
Jesus,
that the Word produces.
Thank you, Lord.
Life on the edge.
Life.
You don't want to live on the edge, beloved. Amen. Who would want to come to church all their life and then bust hell wide open? You might as well, you wasted your time because the truth was always made available.
Yes.
Amen. When you were content to cliffhanger, you were content to live on the edge. You were content to be caught up in your own cares. You were content to not take God at his word.
Amen.
You were content to stay on the edge and hear just enough to make you feel good. Amen. The Bible never said it's going to make you feel good. But the Bible of God's word said, listen, I'll set you free if you believe it.
Yes, 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 yes.
Amen. Jesus said, listen, the sower went forth to sow. He said, some fell on the wayside.
Yes, yes.
On the edge. Some fell on stony ground.
Some
fell. Again, on the edge. Glory to God. Some fell among thorns.
Yes.
Again, on the edge. But he said also, some fell on good ground and brought forth fruit right down the center of God's will. Amen. And produced 100, then 60, then 30. God said, listen, you don't have to live your life on the edge. You can take me at my word, and I will bring forth fruit. God has spoken a promise to you, and all you got to do is believe it and take him at his word. Amen. Don't let the enemy blind you. Don't let the enemy snatch the word of God from you. As soon as you're ready to make a decision, here you go. I got a decision to make. And not believing God and taking God at his word. Willing rather to relinquish the authority to him that seeks to deceive you, rather than take God. Glory to God. Take God at his word.
Amen.
Lord, I'm going to follow you anyhow. Lord, I'm going to follow you regardless of what other people may do. You may be the only saved person in your house. That's all right. God's word is still mighty and powerful.
Amen.
And God's word is still able.
Yes.
You don't have to live your life on the edge. You can live right down in the center of God's will. Glory to God. Glory to God. Truly be blessed, the Lord, on this morning.